Have any of you ever read a book that so changed your life so profoundly that you immediately rushed to your computer and you wrote a gushing fan letter to the author? And I mean the kind of fan letter that is so over the top that it might warrant a restraining order. Anyone else? Okay, I did that. And then, were you ever so lucky that that author actually emailed you back? Anybody else? That happened to me. And then, have you ever been lucky enough to fast forward 3 years, and you are in your dream job, and as part of your dream job, you get to meet the author? And then your organization and her organization start to talk about ways that you could work together in an alliance to change the world. Anybody? Well, I am lucky enough to have had that happen. That author is Susan Cain, and her book is Quiet: The Power of Introverts in a World That Can't Stop Talking. It's a book that so radically changed the way that I, as an extrovert, think about people, talent management, and leadership like no book ever has. And if you have not read this book yet, you will want to. Today, I'm lucky enough to be standing here introducing Susan Cain to you as our plenary speaker in the Organizational Transformation Track at GHC 2016. Susan is the co-founder of the Quiet Revolution and the Quiet Leadership Institute, whose mission is to unlock the power of introverts in the workforce as a diversity lever for the benefit of all employees. And in an enlightening, relatable, and practical talk, Susan will show us that introverts think and work in ways that are crucial to the survival of today's organizations. Drawing on her original research and the latest in neuroscience and psychology, Susan will radically change your view of the best ways to develop leaders, manage teams, and make smart hiring decisions, and to stimulate innovation in your organization. For all the extroverts in the audience, hands up. For all the extroverts in the audience who believe that perhaps the introvert should just learn to be a little bit louder and learn to be more outgoing, this plenary is for you. And for any introverts, hands up for the introverts, for any introverts who have felt like your superpowers have been underutilized and misunderstood in the workplace, this plenary is for you. In fact, this plenary is for all of us who believe that diversity drives everything positive in our organizations, and for everyone who wants to tap into the full potential of all employees in the workforce. I promise you, you will leave this talk today energized and ready to create cultures that embrace introverts and extroverts for the benefits of all. I can't think of a topic with greater potential impact for transforming the culture of technical organizations than this one. Please welcome to the stage my dear friend, Susan Cain.
Well, I'm actually the lucky one to have gotten to know Susan over the years, and to be here with all of you. I think Susan and I have been trying to make this happen for the last 3 years now, and I've for so long wanted to come and be with you all, so thank you for being here. I'm really excited to be here with you. Now, I want to start out by asking you a question, which is, how many of you in the audience recognize this phrase, the problem that has no name? Can you raise your hand if this phrase rings any bells for you? Okay, it's a few of you. This was the phrase that was coined by Betty Friedan in the 1950s when she wrote her groundbreaking book, The Feminine Mystique, which was really the first book that kind of got everybody thinking anew about the problem of women in society. And for her, the problem that had no name was that there was this curious malaise that women were feeling, but nobody had kind of identified it or put their finger on it. And I'm reinvoking this phrase today because we, I believe, now have a different problem that has no name. It has to do with women, it has to do with male introverts as well. The problem is that a third to a half of the population is introverted. That applies to men as well as to women. And for women, there are introverts who are biologically or temperamentally introverted, as well as those who you could say are more socialized that way. And the problem is that our organizations, our workplaces, are not really designed to understand this simple truth. And so if I ask you this question, is the ideal technologist bold, alpha, and gregarious? You know, it seems like a crazy question because of course not, right? You know, the ideal technologist might be bold, alpha, and gregarious in the case of one human, and might be none of those things in the case of another human. And yet I submit to you that right now, the way leadership is defined in our workplaces, and even the way creativity and a good innovator is defined, is as someone who embodies these traits. And I believe that this is the unspoken problem, or one of the unspoken problems that underlies the dearth of women in technology, and that it's a problem for introverts in general. So that's what I want to talk to you about today. I'm beginning with a problem, but the good news is it's actually a problem that's pretty easy to solve. It really just takes a few tweaks in the way we think and design our organizations. Now, before we get started, I want to say a few things about this. Number one, why focus so much on introverts and extroverts? Well, the thing is that temperament matters, and introversion and extroversion, more than any other personality trait, define who we are. So personality psychologists who can agree on practically nothing about the nature of humanity, they all agree on this, that our tendency to be introverted or extroverted defines how we live, how we love, how we work, and that this is true across all cultures. Now, it's also true, though, that we're not talking about introverts here and extroverts over here. We're talking about traits that tend to work and play really well together, tend to be attracted to each other as colleagues, as friends, as partners. And we know from management research that introverts and that the teams that are a mix of introvert and extrovert are the ones that function the best. So what we're talking about here is how can we get to that kind of ideal state of yin and yang where everybody is making the most of who they are. And that, my friends, is the quiet revolution. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about the formal quiet revolution that we've launched, and I'll tell you about that later. But first, I want to share with you how it is that I became so passionate about this topic in the first place. And I think it's true if you look at many people who launch revolutions, often the seeds of these revolutions tend to get planted when you're just a child. You know, it's often a kind of burning observation or problem that the person has identified throughout their lives, and that is how it's been for me. So I want to tell you a story of a time that I was 9 years old, and I went off to summer camp for the first time, and my mother packed for me a suitcase full of books, which in my family was a very natural thing to do if you were going off to the woods for the summer. We were a family of scholars, of readers. Our big group activity was sitting around and reading together. And so I went off to camp for the first time with this suitcase, dreaming that I was going to be, I don't know, hanging out with like-minded campers, all of us reading our novels and our matching nightgowns. But I got to camp on the very first day, and the counselor gathered us around, and she said that she was going to teach us a cheer, which we would then be performing for the rest of the summer. And the cheer went like this. It went, R-O-W-D-I-E, that's the way we spell rowdy, 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 let's get rowdy. Well, I could not figure out for the life of me, why did we have to be so rowdy? And why did we have to spell this word incorrectly? But I just kept on performing that cheer all summer long and doing my best approximation of a rowdy and bold and alpha kind of camper. And I did that not just that summer, but through the rest of my childhood. And then I did it into my young adulthood as well. So much so that I became, for almost a decade, I practiced Wall Street law instead of becoming the writer that I had always longed to be. And this was partly because I was always trying to prove to myself that I could live up to this cultural ideal that I thought we were all supposed to embody, of being that kind of out there person. And I came to see what a huge mistake that was for me personally, but not just for me. I came to see this was a mistake that all of us were making, you know, in our schools and our workplaces. So many of us are trying to be someone other than who we naturally are, and this is a colossal waste of talent and energy and happiness. And so three things that I want to do with you here today. One is to rethink personality, as we've been talking about, and the other is to rethink what impact does thinking about temperament differently have on our notions of creativity. And on that point, I can tell you, you're all attending way too many meetings, and it's getting in the way of your ability to be as creative as you can, because solitude actually matters, and it's time for us to rescue solitude from the cultural myth that everything has to be done all the time in a group, collaboratively. There's a place for collaboration, but not all the time. And then secondly, to rethink leadership, and this in some ways is the heart of it. What do we have in mind when we think of who a good leader is? Who is that person, and what do they embody? And is it always the bold, charismatic person? Those are wonderful traits. There's a whole bunch of others that correlate with effective leadership too, and we're gonna talk about that. But before we move to all that, I wanna get you all thinking a little more deeply about who you are and where you really fall on this introvert-extrovert spectrum. So in my book, Quiet, I have this personality test that I developed based on years of research. We don't have time, really, to get into all the questions on the test now. So we're gonna get at this in a more unorthodox way. I just shared with you a story from my childhood that I think illustrates to you who I really am and where I'm coming from. So I'm just gonna ask you now briefly to break up into groups of four and to share with your group a story that illustrates who you really are. And then I'm going to ask each group to select the most personal and private and poignant of each of these stories and to share them with the room as a whole. And from this collaborative, group-oriented process, a larger truth will emerge. And I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, you guys. We're not gonna do that. We're not gonna do that, and we're not gonna do any such thing, I promise. With apologies for having put you through those moments of discomfort, I do want you, you know, because some of you are like, how can I get out of here right now without insulting the speaker? It was clear to me. But I do want you to think about what you were feeling during those brief moments where you're like, oh my God, I think she's serious. Now, with those apologies, I hope this makes the point that we introverts, we are forever being obliged to participate in these kinds of group exercises, the utility of which often eludes us. And this is not to say that introverts don't like to work on behalf of the group, of the larger cause. We do. We know this from management research. Introverts tend to be quite collaborative in our approach. But it is to say that we prefer the kind of collaboration where everybody gets to go off and work on their own discrete piece of the puzzle, and then you get to come back and share what you've learned in some kind of an ordered way. So I promise now, no trick questions, but I do want you thinking about who you are a little more deeply. So I want to just dive down into what introversion and extroversion really are. For some of you, this will be familiar, but I think even for those for whom it's familiar, I'm going to give you some insights I hope that you haven't heard before. So imagine that you have been at a party for about 2 hours, and imagine that it's a party that where you're having a good time, you're talking to people whose company you truly enjoy. Now, many of you, I'm sure, have heard before the metaphor of a battery and how it gets recharged or drained. So for the extroverts in the room, 2 hours at this party is probably charging your battery. So you're emerging from those 2 hours feeling fully energized and raring for more. But if you're an introvert after those 2 hours, your battery has been slowly draining out, and so you're starting to wish to dear God that you were home in your pajamas. And that metaphor of the battery is extremely useful, but it is just a metaphor. It's a metaphor for what is happening neurobiologically. For those of us who are sort of biological introverts, we can call it. It's a metaphor for what's happening neurobiologically, because the fact is that introverts and extroverts tend to be wired differently, to have different nervous systems. So introverts have nervous systems that just react a little bit more to stimulation of all kinds. And what this means is that we feel at our most alive, switched on, productive, creative, when we are in environments that are a little bit quieter, less stimulation coming at us. And for the extroverts in the room, and I should say, so our liability, therefore, is that when things get to be too stimulating, that's when we feel kind of overwhelming, like there's just too much. Now, for the extroverts in the room, you have exactly the opposite profile. So for you, your liability is when there's not enough stimulation happening, and then you start to get that kind of listless and sluggish feeling that makes you want to check out or try to kind of stir things up a little bit. So your ideal zone is higher level of stimulation. Our ideal zone is more down here. Now, we tend to think of this as, well, let me say this first. These different zones of stimulation, these different wirings that we have been observed in babies as young as 4 days old. So scientists have given babies sugar water to suck on, and sugar water is a form of stimulation just like going to a party is. There's not really a difference from your body's point of view. So in some respects. So what the scientists found is that the babies who salivate more in response to the stimulant of the sugar water are the same babies who, when they're 2 years old and you put them into a playgroup of strangers, are the ones who are gonna be a little bit more like this, because they're reacting more to that stimulation. And when they grow up, they're more likely to be more introverted. And we tend to think of all this stuff as playing out in purely social terms, but there's a lot more to it than that. So the psychologist Russell Gein did a famous experiment where he gave introverts and extroverts math problems to solve with varying levels of background noise playing. And he found that the extroverts did well when the background noise was loud, and the introverts did much better when the background noise was softer. And that, my friends, think about that for a second. That is a profound bit of research. If you're thinking about how you can thrive in your workplace or how to build your organization, you've got to know this research, because what it's telling us is there's no such thing as a one-size-fits-all organization. No such thing. If you want everybody at their best, you've got to have the ability to choose the amount of stimulation in which you're working. And you want to start paying attention to this in your own selves, because our craving for and tolerance of stimulation varies throughout the day for all individuals. So once you become attuned to this, you can start trying to kind of tighter your environment to suit the amount of stimulation you need at that given time, and that's how you're gonna be working at your best. Okay, now having said this, I know that Susan asked you at the beginning, but now that we've done this sort of deeper dive, let me just get a quick show of hands. How many of you would describe yourselves as introverts? Okay, like the whole audience. And how many extroverts? Okay. So you all seem to be over here, and I'm really glad that you came. Thank you for being here. And I should say, too, psychologists have coined the term ambiverts for people who really are kind of in the middle of the introvert-extrovert spectrum. And I often think that ambiverts have the best of all worlds, especially if you're the type of ambivert who can kind of turn it on, go in either direction as needed. And I will say one thing, too, because people often ask me about this. How does the question of shyness fit into all of this? And shyness is a little bit different. In my book and in our work at Quiet Revolution, we are talking about shy people as well as introverted, but it's not quite the same thing. Introversion is what we just described about preferring lower levels of stimulation, whereas shyness is more about the fear of social judgment. So it's a kind of excessive self-consciousness that makes you prefer not to be looked at, that makes you very sensitive to situations where you might feel judged. And in practice, it's kind of Venn diagram. So many introverts are shy, but plenty are not. And then you can have shy extroverts too. So just by way of example, like I think President Obama, for example, is probably a good example of an introvert who's not shy. And then you've got the singer Barbara Streisand, big, larger-than-life personality, who stopped performing for decades, I think it was, because her stage fright was so severe. So, you know, these traits are all complicated, and yet they do come together in a kind of constellation that I think we all recognize. Okay, now, this picture that you're looking at now, hopefully up there somewhere, it's a picture of a music class for toddlers. And if you're looking from a kind of impressionistic perspective, that's what it appears to be. But I want you to look at it more closely, because inside this photograph, you will see the fundamentals of human social dynamics. Because you'll see that some of the children there are cleaving rather closely to the sides of the caregivers who have brought them to this music class. And then you have others, like that little guy in the red jumpsuit who's in the center of the room, who appears to have no idea where his caregiver is, and it's perfectly okay with him. He's probably a bolder and more exploratory type of kid, and the children who are clinging more closely are probably the opposite. They're probably more reserved, more cautious. Now, the silent narrative that is often playing in the minds of the caregivers of the quieter children, it's often a narrative of concern, frankly. It's a narrative that says, you know, this child appears to be getting less out of this experience than some of the other kids in this music class. And, well, who cares about the music class, but maybe this is going to be the story of this child's life. Like, are they always going to get less out of every experience in which they find themselves? And so what I want to say, some of you might be caregivers of such children today, and some of you might be grown-up versions of such children, or partnered with them, or colleagues, or what have you. So what I want to say to all of you is, there's a lot more going on here than meets the eye. Because those kids who are sitting there so quietly, they're not sitting there inertly. They're not inert at all. They're paying a kind of close and careful and subtle attention to everything going on in their environment. And when they're ready, they will often join in. It just takes them longer. But they'll join in, and when they do, they will often have a subtle understanding of the dynamics into which they're entering. And this approach of kind of taking a step back and paying attention to the subtleties of a situation is one of the more sort of unnoticed aspects of what it means to be an introvert. But in fact, scientists have given puzzles, like the one you're looking at here, where the job is to discern the subtle differences between these two pictures. And they've given them to introverted and extroverted children. And you find that on puzzles like this, the introverted kids do better. And there's no IQ difference or anything like that. But they do better because they're using that subtle, I'm going to pay attention to all the little details here, approach. And in the lab, you literally can see their eyes moving back and forth more frequently than the eyes of the bolder children, comparing the differences between the two pictures. And I bet you, when you think about this experiment, and apply it to what you see in the workplace every day, I bet you can think of scores of people who are the ones whose eyes compare more often, and the ones who look at things kind of quickly, get the broad picture, and go. And there is a place for both, God knows. I mean, it's really hard to imagine a successful workplace that doesn't have both types there and working together and their strengths being utilized. And in fact, when you look at many successful organizations, you find people, whether consciously or unconsciously, pairing themselves in these yin-yang formations. One of my favorite examples is at Facebook, where you have Sheryl Sandberg, extrovert, with Mark Zuckerberg, introvert. And as I understand it, Zuckerberg brought Sheryl in, I mean, partly because of her immense talents, in large part, and also because she is an extrovert who could complement his strengths and vice versa. And together, you get much more than the sum of their two parts. And I want to keep hammering this point home, because I don't think we're anything without that kind of yin and yang, but I also don't think that the yin and yang actually does what it can until we get to a cultural point where we can all just sit around and talk about this and joke about it with our colleagues and say, yeah, I'm this way and you're this way, and laugh about the ways in which you approach your problems differently, and harness each other's strengths. So how are we going to do that? First of all, creativity. When psychologists look at who have been the most creative people across a broad variety of fields, they almost always find people who are a mix of introvert and extrovert. So these are people who are extroverted enough that they can go out and exchange ideas and advance their ideas, get them out there. That's important. You could have the best idea in the world, but if no one hears it, it doesn't do anything. But they're also introverts who are comfortable with solitude, perhaps even crave it. So this picture is a picture of Philippe Starck, one of the great designers of our time. And Starck also is running a big business, but he says that every year from May through September, he spends that period of time completely alone. So much so that during this time, he won't attend any parties. He won't even pick up a magazine or watch TV, because he knows that if he wants to figure out what he and he alone can create and believe, he needs to be in solitude to do it. And this is an insight that artists have had for centuries. I mean, for centuries, artists have talked about the mystical power of solitude, but it has become fashionable in the last decade or two to denigrate this and to call it a myth and to say that it's not really there. And in so doing, we are losing one of the greatest powers that we have to innovate. So psychology is actually starting to catch up with the artists to understand just why it is that solitude is so important. And there's all kinds of fascinating studies on this, but I'm just gonna walk you through a few of them just so you get the highlights. So first of all, this one has actually been done for decades. Psychologists have been looking at brainstorming experiments and finding that individuals who brainstorm by themselves produce more ideas and better ideas than groups of people brainstorming together. And this is true for the extroverts as well as the introverts. So the extroverts might enjoy group brainstorming more than introverts do, but it is no more effective for them. So if you want to get the best ideas, you want a more hybrid situation where you're sending people off by themselves to do a deep dive brainstorm, and then you come into the group together and share what you've come up with, and then you go back and forth and toggle. And you know, you shouldn't take my word for it. This is what the psychologist Adrian Burnham concludes based on this research. The evidence from science suggests businesses must be insane to keep using brainstorming groups the way that we do. Recent study out of the Kellogg School. In your typical meeting, you have three people doing 70% of the talking. And I think we all have kind of seen this phenomenon ourselves. Now, there's also the problem in meetings of the conformist impulse. And I would guess that many of you, like me, feel that you're a kind of individualistic thinker, maybe even iconoclastic. No one is going to tell you what to think. And maybe in a lot of ways we are kind of like that, but there's now decades, some of the most robust findings in social psychology that kind of prove us wrong and suggest that all of us are way more deeply conformist than we are often aware of. And I want to take you through some of these studies because they're so important to know about. But first I'm going to play you a funny video clip from one of the very first of these studies that was done in the 1960s. So let me just play this clip for you.
The Ash experiment is one of psychology's oldest and most popular pieces of research. A volunteer is told that he's taking part in a visual perception test. What he doesn't know is that the other participants are actors, and he's the only person taking part in the real test, which is actually about group conformity.
Please begin. The experiment you will be taking part in today involves the perception of line length. Your task will be simply to look at the line here on the left and indicate which of the three lines on the right is equal to it in length. So, for example, if you...
The actors have been told to match the wrong lines. The volunteer will be monitored to see if he gives the correct answer or if he goes along with the opinion of the group and gives the wrong answer. In the first test, the correct answer is two.
One.
Two.
One.
Once again, the correct answer is two.
Three.
Three.
Three. Three.
Yeah, right? That's a kind of horrifying result. And it was repeated in study after study after study in various shapes and forms. But the psychologist who first devised this experiment that you guys just saw, his name was Solomon Ash. And Solomon Ash went to his grave wondering, when the person says three instead of two, do they know that the right answer is two, and they're just pretending in order to curry favor with the audience, with the group? Or have they honestly come to believe that the wrong answer is the right one? So let's take a quick show of hands. How many of you think that they know what the right answer is and they're just pretending? Okay, most of you. And how many of you think that they, I see someone's raising their hand already. How many of you think that they really have changed their minds? Okay, actually got a fair number of you. And you few people who raised your hands on that last point, you were probably right. And I say this because we now have the ability to do these same experiments, but to stick the subject's head inside a brain scanner at the very minute that they're saying effectively three instead of two. And we get a glimpse as to what's going on in their minds. So I want to just take you briefly through one of these experiments. But before we do, a brief disclaimer for the ladies in the audience. You might be uncomfortable with the design of this audience. It was carried out by very well-intentioned researchers, but it might make you uncomfortable. And for the gentlemen in the audience, you are going to come across as somewhat dopey. But we are going to forge ahead in the interest of science. I'll describe this to you. So the researchers took a group of male subjects to whom they showed 180 photographs of female faces, which they were asked to rate for attractiveness on a scale of 1 to 7. And you can see here, you can't see the male subject, but you can see one of the faces that he's rated, and he's given this woman a 4. And then he's about to go on and rate the next face, but before he does, he has a chance to see how a group of his male peers have rated this exact same woman. And hopefully you can see in the back, there's a little red box around the 6, indicating that his peers gave this woman a much higher rating than he did. So he takes this information in, and he goes through the rest of the photos. And then about an hour later, he has a chance to do it all over again. And just as would have been predicted from those earlier experiments, like the video you just saw, he's much more likely now to rate this woman a 6 than he was the first time around, with the only intervening factor being the opinion of his peers. But remember, his head was inside a brain scanner. And it so happens that in our brains, some of you will be familiar, we have reward networks. And these are the dopamine-driven networks that become activated in response to something appealing or to something rewarding, such as the sight of an attractive stranger. And what we see is that this guy's reward networks are much more activated the second time he's seeing the woman than they were the first time. Again, with the only intervening factor being the opinion of his peers, which suggests that even about something as seemingly deep and personal and visceral as who we're attracted to, even then, we take on other people's opinions. And you know, when the researchers go in and ask, they find the subjects have no idea that they're doing this. You know, so we do this with complete non-awareness. And if you doubt this finding, just consider that there would be no advertising industry if this were not so. That's what it's set up to do. And it's because all of us, introverts, extroverts, we're all such social creatures that we're porous. You know, we have porous boundaries, and we survive by caring about and thinking about what other people think and believe about stuff. So we need to take all of that in. The only thing is we sometimes need to put the boundaries up so that we can really go deep and figure out what we think. Okay, so having said that, how might we run our meetings differently? Now, this is a topic we could talk about all day long, and we often do with Quiet Revolution, but I'm just gonna give you a couple tips for today. First, for the introverts in the room, and then for the extroverts. Okay, so for the introverts, Next time you go to a meeting, think in advance what you would like to say, to communicate, to share, and give yourself a push to speak up early, which for many of you is going to feel completely unnatural. But I want you to give it a try of just maybe be the first one to speak up or the second one. Give yourself that push, because there's lots of research showing that the first people who speak are kind of the anchoring ones. Their ideas become the anchor ideas around which everybody then comments. And even more importantly, you become a kind of emotional anchor. So people start then directing their attention and energy back to you. Whereas if you wait to speak, the exact opposite thing happens, and you kind of go more and more to the margins of the room, and it becomes that much harder to interject later. Second point for introverts, to remember when you're feeling enthusiastic about something, you know, a project or a team success, let's say, to remember to actually show it outwardly, which is something we don't often do. Now, my husband is an extrovert, and he has this very delightful way of expressing enthusiasm about all the amazing things that might happen. So just for example, when my book hit the bestseller list, you know, he was so excited, and he was jumping up and down, and he was going, "Koo-loo-loo-loo-loo," and he was just like really excited about it. And believe me, I was just as excited. It was my book, and I was the one who wrote it. But my version of expressing that exact same thing, same emotion, really, my version of that was like, yeah, it's great. It's great. So it's a much more muted means of expression, but the underlying feeling's not any different. But what I always have to remember, as his wife, I have to remember that when something exciting happens for him, I've got to give myself that push to express it a little more outwardly than I otherwise would, because that's what he's looking for. And if it doesn't come, he might think I don't care as much. And of course, he, by the same token, has to remember that when I'm a little more muted, it doesn't mean lack of enthusiasm. So you start to see how just understanding these key differences about each other and being able to talk about them as if it's no big deal can repair so many misunderstandings, avert misunderstandings from happening in the first place. Okay, now, extroverts, you on the other hand, can stand to curb your enthusiasm a little bit. And I don't want to make you self-conscious about this, because we introverts love your enthusiasm. It's like really fun to be around. I want to say, though, that when you're in a meeting, for example, start paying attention to how much of the talking you're doing, how many of the ideas you're advancing, and make sure you're hearing from other people too. So Sheryl Sandberg, who we were just referring to before, actually hired a coach to help her to speak less at meetings, because she saw that there were people whose ideas weren't even getting to the table, and those are good ideas, and you want to be hearing them. So a little mindfulness on that. And then second, to know that if you want to get the best of an introvert's heart and mind, you're probably not going to get it in a group. You might, but probably not. Odds are against you, and you want the odds in your favor. So instead, reach out to the person you want to speak to one-on-one and give them advance notice of what it is you want to talk about, because by definition, introverts want to process stuff before we articulate it. And I can't even count the number of times introverts have said to me, yeah, you know, by the time I thought of the thing I wanted to say, the meeting was over, and like, it's too late, and then the idea is lost. Okay, now I want to switch gears to leadership. How many of you have read the book Good to Great? Okay, a handful of you. So Good to Great is a book that was based on a groundbreaking study by Jim Collins, who did a study of the top 11 best performing companies in the US at the time. He wanted to figure out what set these companies apart from their more mediocre peers. And he found that every single one of these 11 companies, every single one of them, was led by a CEO who was described by their peers, by the people who worked for them, as quiet, modest, unassuming, soft-spoken, even shy. So this whole constellation of traits that we normally think of as being the opposite of what makes a leader, in this case, every single one of the best companies was led by such a person. And what could possibly explain that? Well, I think the explanation is going to resonate for a lot of you in this room. Because the thing is that introverts, by their nature, tend to want to go deep into one or two or three subject areas of passion. And they're often not seeking leadership positions for the sake of being a leader. Sometimes they are, but you know, no general, I don't want to overgeneralize here, but in general, they're not, I want to be a leader, I don't care of what. It's rather that they, in the service of these passions, they will start acquiring expertise, building networks, inspiring trust in the people around them, and they end up becoming leaders. They end up becoming leaders in the service of these passions. And this is why when you look around, you can see many of these leaders. And I'm gonna give you some rather well-known examples, but the well-known ones are kind of less important. The real work that we all need to do is to be thinking about who are the leaders among you in your daily lives, and maybe you yourselves who fit this bill. So this is Beth Comstock, who is currently the vice chair of GE. Many people believe she's gonna be the next CEO. And she talks often about being an introvert who, yes, steps out of her comfort zone all the time, but draws all the time on her strengths of being really curious and wanting to go deep into a topic and think deeply about it, and building one-on-one alliances behind the scenes. This is one of my favorite people, Douglas Conant, who until recently was the CEO of Campbell Soup, a company whose reins he took when it was literally at the bottom of the Fortune 500 for employee engagement. And by the time he left 10 years later, it was all the way at the top. And Doug is very shy and introverted, as he will be the first to tell you. And he found a way of connecting with people that drew on who he was as a person. So in this picture, you see him writing a letter. He used to write letters. He used to find out who were the employees at Campbell who were really contributing and really giving their all. And he would sit down and write to these people personal notes of thanks. And during his time at Campbell, he wrote 30,000 of these letters. So 30,000 letters. An extroverted leader would find a completely different way of connecting with people. And that's fine too. The point really is that we tend to think that there's only kind of one accepted social path towards leadership, towards creativity, towards sales, towards you name it, and that's just not true. We're much more complex than that as humans. And then this is Gandhi, who was so shy when he was a child. He used to run home from school as soon as the bell rang in order to avoid socializing with his classmates. And he remained this way throughout his life. You should take a look at his autobiography. He talks about always being uncomfortable in meetings, never being the one to want to keep the conversation going. But that style can turn out to have a curious potency of its own, because people can feel when a leader is there, not because they want to control events or be in charge, but rather almost because they have no choice. You know, they're just so committed to the task at hand or to the mission before them that the other people who are similarly committed will align with them, and together they get it done. Okay, so what to do about all this? Well, I have a few takeaways for you before we move to Q&A. Number one, I'm gonna ask all of us, because of us being here today at a conference, to rethink what it means to network. Now, I happen to know from all the thousands of letters that I get that if there's one thing that is probably the bugaboo of introverts the world over, it is having to network. And I want to invite you to think about networking completely differently, which is to say, when you like walk around this conference or any conference, your job should be to look for the kindred spirits who are here. So forget about working the room, forget about like, oh, I really gotta, you know, go out there and represent my company, or whatever narrative you've got in your mind. Forget that. Just look for the kindred spirits whose company you truly enjoy, the people you, honest to God, want to keep in touch with when you're done, honest to goodness, want to be helpful to when you're finished, and maybe even have a quota system, you know, that you want to meet three of such people, five, seven, I don't know what's right for you. After you've met them, you get to go back to your hotel room and rent a movie and put on your pajamas. And I'm telling you, if you approach life this way, where all that really matters are the kindred spirits, and you get to also honor your own needs to be on your own and to cocoon a little bit, your network 5 years from now is going to be so much richer and deeper than if you approach it in the more mechanistic way. Okay. Second point is, notwithstanding everything I have just said, I really want to make it clear that I do believe that all of us, extroverts, introverts, polka dotted, all of us need to step outside our comfort zones for the sake of the work and the people that we love. And if this were not true, I would right now be sitting alone at a library with my laptop in hand. But instead, I am here with you today. So, you know, stepping outside your comfort zone matters. But the key is, as I said, and I'm drawing here on the work of the psychologist Brian Little, who talked about the need to like really identify what are your core personal projects in work and in life. What are those core projects? And once you know what they are, it's worth it in the service of those core projects to step outside your comfort zone. So don't just make yourself uncomfortable for no great purpose. Do it for something that really matters, because then it's going to be worth it. And then when you've done it and you've gone outside, you're doing it from the perspective still of a feeling of entitlement to be who you are. So yeah, I was out there, out of my comfort zone for the sake of something bigger, but now I'm back being me. And once you start approaching life that way, you know, it trickles down into all different avenues. So for example, you might start scheduling your daily calendar differently. You might say, okay, I know on Monday I've got a day full of meetings, so I'm gonna schedule lunch completely with myself. And I'm gonna honor that commitment to have lunch in solitude just as carefully as I would honor a commitment with a client. Those are the kinds of tweaks you start making. Okay, and then finally, I want to ask each of you right now to think about who is a so-called unlikely leader who you know, who's somebody who's supremely talented or just great in whatever way, but someone who doesn't meet that mold of what you think a leader or thought a leader was supposed to look like. And maybe it's you, and maybe it's someone else you know. And what could you do to sit with that person today, tomorrow, next week? Really sit down with them and figure out where do they want to be in 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, and what could you do to help them make that happen? Not by telling them to turn into something else or someone else, but by drawing on the amazing strengths that they already have. Now, I just want to say, for those of you who are intrigued by all of this, you're not out there doing it alone. So I told you at the beginning, we've started a whole choir evolution movement and organization. So about a year and a half ago, I think it is, we launched a website, quietrev.com. For those of you who are interested in reading more about this and connecting with a community of people who are passionate about these causes. And in the last year, we have started a Quiet Ambassador program where we are going into schools, workplaces, universities, with the idea ultimately, because we dream big, of being in every school, every university, every workplace in 10 years, to create quiet ambassadors who are learning all about how to take these ideas into their workplaces and then propagate them with their colleagues and kind of become leaders in their own right around this topic. And we started this out this past year with our first partner, LinkedIn. You're looking here at a picture of the very first cohort of LinkedIn ambassadors, and very excited to see where that goes going forward. I'm gonna end where I began, which is, I began with my suitcase full of books, right? That I told you I carry with me everywhere I go, still do to this day. But I wanna ask you now to think about what's in your suitcase. Like, what are the things that you carry with you, maybe literally, maybe metaphorically, what are the things that you carry with you everywhere you go? And why did you put those things inside your suitcase? Why do they matter so much to you? What really, really matters to you? Now, for the extroverts in the room, once you've identified what those things are, it's probably quite natural to you to take those things out of your suitcase and to share them with the people around you. For the introverts in the room, it might be somewhat less natural for you to do that. It might instead be your impulse to guard rather carefully the items in your suitcase. And that's okay too. I only want to urge you every so often to take those things out and share them with the people around you, because the world needs you and it needs the things you carry. And so in closing, I want to say to all of you, to wish you all the best of all possible journeys, and may you have the courage to speak softly. Thank you. Thank you very much.